Christmas time. Oh, how it's changed down through the years. Still the same message, but celebrated a little bit different. I'm old enough to remember what it was like for me growing up. I remember, just before Christmas, the turkey arriving at the house, hanging on the back of the door, my mother then preparing it for Christmas dinner. Now, the Christmas turkey is bought in shops, in most cases. Then, on St. Stephen's Day, we'd all go out mumming, on the wren. It's a tradition that's now fading out. I often wondered what it was like for those who grew up during the 1930s and 1940s at Christmas time, and I hope during this programme that we can share that message. I started out by asking Jackie Lee from Ahacashel in County Leitrim, did they put Christmas decorations up?
Oh, you would. You'd have a Christmas tree and you'd have the paper decorations around the one room in the house anyway, the main room in the house, and maybe some of the other rooms as well, not so much up in the bedrooms now, but on the ground floor, you'd put up the decorations for Christmas, for the 12 days of Christmas, and then take them down then after that.
So they come down around the 7th, would it be?
Around that, yeah, around that.
Little Christmas.
It's really the 12 days of Christmas anyway.
John Joe Farrell had this to say about a very important feature at Christmas time.
Oh, there would, but there was one thing very important to put up on Christmas, that was the holly. The holly. And there was holly put up on everything.
Elizabeth Moffatt, also known as Babby Costello, grew up in Gowal in County Leitrim, and she also has fond memories of the holly.
Holly in the winter.
Yeah.
Look, the holly in the field. Oh, they loved holly. It was the real old, you know, the holly. And if you could get red berries on the holly, oh, that was very precious. We should go on down the field and pick the holly. And if some house, some old person, they'd bring it to them, the holly to them. Oh, the holly was great, but there was nothing like decorations or, you know what I mean.
I asked John Joe McGirl what life was like for him growing up at Christmas time in the late 1930s.
Well, look, it was a big, it was something big at that time, but there was nothing, big now. There was Christmas every day now.
It was homely, we'll say, yeah. No one ever went over the house on Christmas Day or Christmas night. No, Christmas Day. It was supposed to be a family thing, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was quiet, you know. When we grew up then, it was different, you know.
God, the presents you get. Santa wouldn't be killed carrying his present anyway.
I asked Pat Flynn from Gowlie Kesh Carrigan what Santa Claus was like when he was growing up.
Oh, a great man. Oh, man, he was very respected. You see, yeah, yeah. But he always came down the chimney, you see. He always came down the chimney.
Do you know the way you can go into a shop now and Santa is in the corner and he's meeting people and they're getting their photograph taken with them and he's given a present? Would anybody, would you have gone to see Santa Claus any place locally back then?
Well, Santa wanted to be had that then, like you mean, say. He came from the North Pole. He wanted like nowadays, like you mean, say, you can meet him in the places that he calls it, like that. But he wasn't mentioned that time. He wanted to be had that time. Like, man, he came from the North Pole.
And would you have wrote a letter to him?
Yeah, all beyond means. Oh, aye. Oh, aye. No mistake.
Well, we wrote out our letters anyway and posted them off to Santa Claus and what we wanted. And when the time came, then we got what we asked for, kind of.
And what kind of things would you ask for in the letter?
Apples, oranges and sweets and all that.
Did Santa come?
I think he used to, but I don't know. Would we get a lot?
Yeah.
Well, it was apples and oranges, and that's all. It was some fruit, that's all. Could be a lot of those. It was no toys.
Them toys wanted to be had in our time. They were there, but they didn't come into their year. One toy to be had that time.
And would you write to Santa long before Christmas?
I'd have hung up your stocking.
And can you remember those nights when you'd be going to bed on Christmas Eve?
Oh, and they were. Yeah, yeah. They were never spoke. But they were not ever spoke in the morning. And that was spoke early in the morning.
When Santy would come, well, some kind of little train, train on a track, a little engine and a couple of three or four carriages then behind on a little track. We used to have that, maybe we might get that, Santy might bring us that at Christmas.
God rest ye merry gentlemen, let nothing you dismay. Remember Christ our Saviour was born on Christmas Day to save us all from Satan's power.
And would you rear your own turkey, or how would that
go? Oh, rear our own turkeys, oh, definite. Oh, definite. Yeah, yeah, yeah. They'll flock the turkeys, I think. Flock the turkeys.
When would you get the turkey, could you remember, to start fattening them up for Christmas?
I suppose a couple of months before Christmas, maybe September or October.
What would the turkey eat in the run-up to Christmas?
Whatever we left over after our own meals, then we give that to the animals, the birds and the turkey, the hens and the turkeys.
But here, when we were young, we should have about 30 turkeys, and they were all sold. We didn't kill one. She had chickens for ourselves. And what all they got, they're only pennies for a pound of a turkey. And the hardship they had tried to sell them at a big market day.
We'd have, mightn't have turkey, but we'd have chicken and...
They don't realise at all the situation that was that in there.
And they'd all go to the market
all
then?
All have to go to the market.
And would they be all, we'll say, prepared by the time that they go to the market, or would they be still alive?
No, they'd be still alive. And the buyers would come there, and they all killed them at night and packed them over, going to England or wherever they were going.
And would that be a local market then?
Oh, the big market, used to call it. There'd be a fortnight before Christmas.
And where would that be?
In some shambo. There'd be lines of turkeys out.
So there'd be a lot of, we'll say, local people that would have reared the turkeys.
Oh, nearly everyone had a turkey, had a few turkeys.
And had you any problems back then with pine martens or minks or anything?
No, the fox was the only thing that he often desolated a whole flock of turkeys.
He'd have a good Christmas.
He'd had a good Christmas.
And how would you go about preparing the turkey then, Jackie? Was there a certain time frame where the turkey would have to be...
Well, I suppose,
and I hope we don't offend anybody listening, but to kill the turkey.
It was the women looked after feeding the turkey, and then the turkeys were killed then, for especially around Christmas time, and then during the year as well. Besides having to buy in the butchers, a lot of people had their own turkeys and they fattened them up, and then they killed them and used them on the table then.
And it'd last a few days.
Last a few days, yeah.
Well, that was it. You see, the women, they had a flock of turkeys, and they fed the turkeys, and it was very important then for to have good turkeys for the buy provision for the Christmas. And there was things bought at Christmas that you wouldn't see only at Christmas time.
So the turkey then would be done, and how would that be cooked back then? Because there wouldn't have been ovens.
They were cooked in an oven on the fire. And there were grates that time, and there were the fires in the grates, and there was a crook, and you hung your pot on the crook, and you cooked your turkey. That's the way you were cooked. And every Christmas, there was a pig killed, like I mentioned, in a lot of houses.
Yeah, we had pigs too. And pigs would be killed and hung up and used them for so many months then after that.
And then when the pig would be roasted, then that would be the ham?
Yeah, yeah. Oi.
And how would you keep the meat from the pig?
You get a butcher in and do up the meat. He killed the pig, we'll say, and then we use the meat then in the house then for the people living in the house to use the pig meat. And then we fold, then we used to fatten up the turkeys and the chickens and use them then, besides having to buy them in the butchers. You'd have your own meat.
So on Christmas Day, when you'd look at the table, the turkey was reared, fattened up on the farm.
Yeah.
The same with the ham for the pig. The potatoes probably came from a heap down in the field.
The potatoes in a heap, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they had their own potatoes and they had their own vegetables.
They all had a few days before the Christmas, they had to reel the bags of potatoes out of the field and have the vegetables.
Oh, I had a great vegetable garden over there. I used to have everything you could think of now, and a lot of stuff used to go to loss. Well, every vegetable you could think of, I used to have in over there. It was a very good garden.
And then?
You went out to the garden and you decided whatever your dinner, and you went out and you had it in the garden and good and fresh.
And I remember talking at home to Mam and that, and you put the potatoes in and you covered them up then, and as you needed them throughout the year, you go down and you take out whatever you needed and...
Put them in a heap, like a man say, and cover them with rushes and put clay on top of that then again, do you see? And...
So you do it in layers?
Yeah.
The heap of potatoes would be from here to the outside door, and they were, you know, up a wood round. Attached with rushes and covered over with clay.
Yeah.
And they last the whole year?
That's the whole year. Yeah, yeah.
And would there have ever been any problem with, we'll say, rats or anything like that?
Oh, we had them too, weren't you? We had them too all the time. Yeah. You did down poison for them.
And you want to be careful when you be going down getting a few spuds in case you might come across a rat inside trying to have a bit of dinner.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, he'd be there already, he'd get his hole on the clay, into the clay. He'd get his hole, yeah, yeah.
And if you want the potatoes, of course, at that time, Sean says, you would eat them on Friday to the market yard. Yeah. And there was another farmer there selling potatoes, you see.
And then the seed potato then that you would have put in that time, where would that come from, or would you hold on from it?
Generally your own seed, but then the seed, there was department seeds. the department used to, I don't know where it used to come. You could buy, there was a time appointed to be an agricultural man that would, you'd get a couple of bags maybe from and pay them, and then they came to the station and they were seed potatoes, you see. Mm. And you might have all your own seed.
The milk that went into
the cows. From the cows.
The water came from the well up the road, Armstrong's
well, yeah. And we had to carry the water from the well in buckets.
You had to go to the well for a gallon of water. You could have a good bit to go in the summertime. You could have a good bit to go because there were some very good springs.
Yeah. And what well now would be local to where you are?
Oh, there was a well went through the country back down that. It would be...
Down towards Drumchamba.
It would be down towards the lake that way.
Yeah.
That were to be nearly a mile across.
That time the water wasn't laid on, then eventually then the water was laid on, it was piped into the houses. But before that you carried the water from the well in a bucket.
And whose job would that be normally?
The children in the house.
That did go off with a gallon, maybe 2 gallons.
There was a good lot of swings around goal. Good swings. But that we only used to drink or for tea. You'd have to collect water for to wash clothes and things. The spring water was supposed to be very good. We should run out the spring then and then wash it out. And the pure water come up between the flags. You see it coming up. You were supposed not to interfere with the spring. I always heard that. That wasn't lucky to interfere with the spring. And then the people crossing land, there'd be so many going. And that was very unlucky if you closed the spring well. I often heard that told. Mm. If you had a spring well on your land and you closed it, that'd be unlucky.
Did you ever hear of the stray sod?
You did. And you go the wrong way, was it?
I knew a woman now that it happened too, and she said that she took off her jumper and turned it inside out.
Oh, I heard about that.
And then when she put it back on, then...
She got home.
There was very few things bought that time. Tea and sugar and flour. It'd be the most things that could be bought. The rest of it was people provided themselves. So.
And the flour would be in big bags, but like meal?
Tin store bags.
That time you baked, you done a lot of your own homework, cooking.
Yeah.
And you'd get two of them at Christmas. You'd think there was going to be a famine. You know, you always lifted a big supply of stuff.
Well, they made their own cakes. They bought the flour and they made their own cakes at home, and then they used them on the table for the children and for the adults in the house. They didn't buy a loaf in the shop.
Was there always a shop here, or...?
No, there was. My grandfather, he came from Arigna, and he started the shop. Then my father was at it, and then I was at it. So we had the shop and supplied all the locals around us food and water, and besides having to go to town, we were able to supply the local neighbours with whatever they needed for the put food on the table. The first car around here, we had it. My grandfather, and then my father, and then I was at it. So we had our own private car, and then we had taxis, and then we had a hearse, a motor hearse, and we had sold the coffins and did the undertaking, and we sold the coffin, and then most people, if they bought a coffin, then they wanted it lined up inside.
Mm.
They didn't do that themselves, so they bought the coffin ready and all for the corpse to go into the coffin. And then we had the hearse, and then we had two taxis in as well.
And the tradition back then would have been, you know, for a lot of deceased to wear habits.
Habits, yeah.
And that seems to be a tradition that, if you pardon the pun, has died out.
Well, we sold the habits in the shop, and then if anyone wanted a coffin, then we sold the coffin, and we put the linings in the coffin and did it up, and the breastplate with the person's name on it and the lid of the coffin went off then and collected the corpse and was brought off then to the church. Removal was on one day and then the funeral was the next day.
How would Christmas be celebrated then in the house on Christmas morning? Would there be mass and, or how would all that work out?
Mass on Christmas morning, yeah. It'd be at 11 or half 11 or like that, you see. And it was all foot that time. There were no cars. You had to walk. You had no cars.
Can you recall the Latin mass?
Oh, I remember. They served mass for years.
But it was the Latin.
Oh, aye.
Who would have been the local priest in the area then when you would have been going
when you
were younger?
There were two priests in my town. There were two priests, like I mentioned. There was a parish priest and a cure priest. Father Kieran, Canon Gobbygood and Canon Kieran, no, and Father Nish Gobbygood, the two of them. They were the two priests in the parish.
So from the beginning until the end, it would be all in Latin?
Yeah, it was.
Practically.
There'd be two masses on Christmas morning.
And I suppose back then, maybe those who were in the congregation, they probably had a little bit of Latin. It was probably taught in schools, wasn't it?
It was. The minute the priest started the mass, they started to say the rosary. And it was, no idea really what was going on.
I know you had the Latin off, you had it off the heart, but she hadn't a clue what it stood for.
He could be saying something and everybody else would be saying the Hail Mary.
Was one crowd saying the Hail Mary and the priest tried to say a mass in Latin. Was it in October? There used to be the rosary, all of St. Master Conniff, he was a great man for saying that. And the minute the priest came on the altar, he started with the prayers, and he breaked in at the consecration and started in when the communion was over, and it'd be finished at about the same time as the priest.
And it would have been, mass then would have been different, we'll say, compared to now with the crowds as well. And a lot of people probably cycling to mass and...
Oh, quit your walking.
Where would you go to mass? Would it be Drumcong?
Drumcong, yeah. You had to say, all the gospel said you had to serve mass during a week. Serve mass or come back here, go to school the day after that.
And so you'd have to leave early in the morning for
you
that?
You had to be over for a mass for the priest for 8 o'clock. I'd have to walk, you had no bicycle or anything.
Yeah. And I tell you, another point I want to say. In my time, people wore clogs. You ever hear of clogs?
They were a shoe, were they?
They were a shoe. A number of timber turned into the sole of a shoe. And it was shod. And how was it shod? Hands of buckets. The blacksmith, he gave you a young fella, he gave you a 2 or 3 shillings, and you bring him and serve old hands of buckets. And he converted them into the bottom of the cloud, you see, to keep it from shipping. And he gave that to the man who made the cloud. And he fitted on to the number timber. Yeah, I seen the clog myself.
Yeah,
to the number timber. Yeah.
And when you were going to school now, Pat, where would you have gone to school?
To Shannigan.
And would that be for national school and secondary school?
National school and vocational.
Yeah.
Yeah, the vocational school.
And can you remember the teachers' names in it?
But wouldn't I? Master Gannon, Mrs. Feynman, Mrs. Timoney. Yeah. Yeah.
And would there have been many in the school at the time?
Oh, there could be 50 or 60, I suppose.
What was school like then?
Oh, it was all right. It was all right. Yeah, grand. You all don't see a summer coming. You throw off the shoes and go on the bare ones. The bare feet. You all take that. And the road was rough, but no one ever passed them out. There wasn't too many tire roads that time.
So no. They'd be more like passes, would they?
Oh, they'd be ordinary roads. They could say they wasn't hard. They could that's the way.
Yeah. Would the cane have been about that time?
Oh, it would. Yeah.
Did you ever get a whack of it?
No, it was. I didn't get enough of it. That's the one trouble. I didn't get enough of it. Yeah.
And then another tradition years ago was mumming.
Oh, aye.
And would that have been something that you would have done?
Many the time. On foot. All on foot. That's the way.
So you call around to the neighbours' houses,
that's right,
and
that's right.
You'd sing a couple of Christmas songs or carols.
Yeah. Oh, aye.
Silent Night and Jingle Bells. Yeah. Would they have all been songs?
They would. Yeah, surely.
Oh, aye. The children you go round to the houses, St. James's Day.
Mumming.
Aye, it's right. And then I used to go myself with a couple of other young ones around. We thought that was great sport.
And what kind of things would you get then when you'd sing those songs?
You got coppers anyway, but you wouldn't get too much. It's one to be had. That's the way. You get money, but you wouldn't get in pounds or anything like that, no. It was rather more that time than now.
It was a local wedding to be in the house, you know. And myself and some of the other girls, neighbour girls, we dress up and go to the wedding house. God, that was great fun. We're going to a dance on St. Stephen's night. And that was great. Get out the next night.
Yeah.
We walk it until Leitrim Hall. Walk it. And walk back. And we're getting our refreshments. Great fun.
Or what about the days before electricity? You know, as we record this now, coming up to Christmas, and we look outside, it's almost dark, and it's only 4:30 in the evening. In a lot of places around rural Ireland, electricity didn't arrive until maybe
night. Mid-50s, wasn't it? The mid-50s. Tom Shamu was lit up. Mr. Laird, he had a mill and he had a garage. Great family in the church of Shamu, and he lit the town. That's the way back.
I spoke to Noel McPartland, and there was a man, Jack Kane, who came down, and he used to look after all
of that. That's right, Jack, big Jack Kane.
That the just on the electrification side, we had the electricity here from 1905 until 1955, due to the good offices of Caleb Laird, who was the founder of C.S. Laird Limited. And he supplied electricity to the town from 1905 until rural electrification came in 1955. And we were well ahead of a lot of other towns. But there was actually a lot of towns from, say, Ballyconnell, Belturbet, Ballyconnell, down into Drumshambo, onto Boyle, Sligo, with the same type of systems. It was the old DC system, I think, and it was pretty reliable. I was reared in Drumshambo as a born and reared here, and I can remember the electric light so well because I only lived four doors up the street from it. And when you hear you'd hear this hum from the time the light would come on during the evening, in the winter time, and it would go off about midnight, and then you could go back to sleep. Just an amazing memory from that, you know.
That's right, yeah.
How did you spend the evenings when it would get dark then?
Well, we had lamps, oil lamps, and lit oil lamps. And that was before the electricity came, we had to depend on oil lamps.
But I often can't understand how there was only candles and a bad little single wick lamp on the wall. And the women done both sewing and patching clothes and knitting and all the work they done at night. And if you see, that we had a candle lit here without the other day, the light.
Yeah.
And if you found out what that was like.
Yeah. And we'll say that moment now when the light went out the other day, and you would have lived through the time when there would have been no light.
Yeah.
How did you find the difference?
You thought you'd be back old times again, you thought. But the people had better eyesight than them. They could walk at night with a candle or read a book or read a paper. No, with a candle, you can imagine a candle lit now.
Myself and my brother used to go on the road. There was a lot of houses in Gaol that time, and we'd walk up and down watching the lights. We thought that was great, you know, the lights in the houses.
We thought that it was all right, but sure, the men folk all carried. The woman in the house then, knitting sweaters. All that.
Scarves and...
And the socks and then was darning going on and sewing, and they were at that, and they had their own entertainment. But then again, they'd have to kill it house where the watchers sit round and they'd be telling stories. The Caelian house then was far and again it, because the thing about it is that you get an old man there and there'd be children in the house, and he'd tell ghost stories, and they were great to tell stories. Well, they'd be fretting their shirt from the listeners, you know. And such a thing, and such a place on the road.
Yeah.
The foot of Camel's Hill, the beyond where the old creamery was. It was good, but did it? It was a, if there was a bad tale to it, you see.
Yeah.
If there was a bad tale to a story and you tell it, you couldn't keep it. You'd have to tell it to someone, and you tell it easy, but don't tell anyone, you see.
Yeah.
And that would drown it boy for you. The present generation today that have no time for that.
Don't yeah.
listen to you if you had some kind of a bad story. Well, that was one not a good point in it. The only good point was a good game of cards was great at night.
Yeah.
And evening with the light. The light wasn't great. And still the plinth cards. So I bit the goes down there in that corner so you wouldn't see. So there's the lamp on the table there now.
It's one of the old, it's a paraffin light with a wick out of it. And a lovely glass tube coming up from it.
The globe.
Yeah.
The globe. Well, that was it. And
that's what you depended on back then. And would there be many of them? Would there be many of them in the house?
One. It was one. And there was, in a lot of houses, there was a lamp hung on the wall lamp. Just for 1 week.
Yeah.
1 week. Some of them had a double week. And then there was what they called, they came in and light in the tilly lamp.
The tilly was a big thing that when it came. It came before the
tilly lamp, and there was a mantle on it. There was a mantle on it, and you pumped it. Yeah, you pumped it. The mantle was very easy to have it in the mantle. But it was a good light.
Yeah.
The boat was a good light. Before Christmas, they talk about a giant.
Ah, that'd be giants at Christmas.
It'd go at the head this year, they talk about running a giant, where they'd take in so many men for they'd be drinking, and so many teetotalers, and put a charge on the didn't know what drinking. It'd have to be so much. And didn't the teetotalers got away with a good bit less?
Local neighbours said, each one would give so much, and they go and they'd buy a, the Quinty Carrick and buy a barrel of porter and bring it home. Yeah, and we the girls would get tea.
Yeah.
That's all we get. And we're glad if we got a cup of tea. And then there was local musicians, you know. There was Brian, that'd be Jimmy Brian's brother, Peggy Brian. He was a great fiddle player, and there was a bottom spell over it. Over at King of Cross, and he used to play the accordion, and Becky Bryan played the fiddle, and they were great. I wish. That'd be only every year. We'd dance all night.
And then they'd have to get a house with someone. Someone would give the house for the night, and you had to get musicians. You had plenty of musicians through the country, good fiddle players, and accordion and flute players. And what you had at that time then, you had a lot of men that had those good step dancers.
Yeah.
Step dancers, and they'd be, they'd be run very well. Them two men, a couple of men was at the head of it, and they'd be a step put to the dancing, and there'd be someone called for to sing a song, and there'd be there'd be a couple of songs sung, and there'd be someone to dance and sing the tordon.
And would these be mainly held at Christmas?
That was Christmas.
When they'd have it in one house, then would they have it in another house in another house?
This area here. Well, they didn't back down the road there. They could have a giant down there.
And could you have two giants on the one night?
You could. It was up to the... it wouldn't be that pitiful, do you see? They're not all that pitiful.
And for the people then that would be drinking at the giants, what would they be drinking, or would it be...
Oh, porter.
Porter.
Porter was the half barrel of porter was generally inside the door in the room.
Yeah.
And some of those men was in charge of the porter.
Probably a drop of punching.
The porter round about, not right.
And a drop or two of punching, probably.
I never knew much about the punching around here, now. But it could be, you wouldn't know.
And what about the narrow gauge railway? Did you ever travel on it?
I did, yeah. It went from Arigna down to Drumshambo, and Drumshambo then on to Baltimore, and then on to Belturbet. And on a fair day in Drumshambo, the cattle would be brought on the train on the narrow gauge and go to Drummond to transfer the cattle and people as well in Drummond on the wide gauge, and that went from Sligo to Dublin.
I wonder, they would have used coal back then to probably get the engine moving. I wonder, did they ever use coal from Bin Croy?
To be Rigna and Bin Croy, I think two. Mostly Rigna, but Bin Croy was the local one here, and they used to get the coal there from Cullen Gannon. Bin Croy is up the mountain. Leaving Éireann Mountain, and Bin Croy, as you go out to Ballyglera, the coal mines were up there.
And is there still coal there?
There would be coal, but it's not mined at the moment.
Can you recall the Bin Croy coal? Was it good coal?
It was. The local fellas, the young lads around here, now after leaving school, they worked in the coal mines. And they went in, and it was damp. There was water running in the underground coal mines, and there'd be sometimes rats crawling around. But
they say that where the rats are, there's ear, so it's a good sign.
A good sign, yeah. When the rats would leave, you'd know that the air was nearly gone. The pure air was gone, because that was the first sign you'd see when you see the rats leaving. It was time for the human beings to leave at the same time.
And where we are here talking to you, there's a lovely photograph over us of the narrow gauge passing. Is it this house here? There's a photograph of the narrow gauge. That's passing by here, is it?
Between the road and the house here.
Yeah.
And I mind the bus coming from school one day, and there was not a hero in the four walls. It was burnt. This is a steam, they say. And they say the sparks, if you see them at night when they be pulling, there was showers of sparks going up all the way up to the sky.
And
they were supposed to carry what they called spark arresters, for to keep down the spark, but they used to do that because that used to affect the fire for to put up steam.
And of course, that time a lot of houses probably had thatch, would it be?
Oh, they were all thatched.
Yeah.
Not all thatched, but they were nearly all thatched.
And it would have been any spark at all?
No, in dry weather, And it was a great boom to the Rochambeau, to the fair for getting away cattle. Because the fair of the Rochambeau, them men from the north, and that cattle dealers, they were, the northern buyers was good buyers, and they'd buy a lot of cattle. Well, they had to walk them to keg station. There was what they called drovers. There was men set for the to meet them, do you see, to drive their cattle to the station.
And what route would they take for that then?
Oh, they'd come from the Rochambeau to Leitrim village. Or the Leitrim village through the town of Carrick out to the station.
And then they'd be put on the train and...
Put on the train and where their destination would be, I don't know.
Yeah. No. Would you walk along the line into Drumshambo or...
Oh, if you were walking
at all. Was there another pass?
If you were walking at all, you walked on the railroad line.
Yeah.
You walked from sleeper to sleeper.
Yeah.
So at that time, we'll say Drumshambo would be well known for its local mart.
Yeah.
Farmers market. At that time, this train would have brought in and out livestock as well?
Oh, yes. And on big occasions, such as the Port Yonkin indulgences in the church, the 1st and 2nd of August, there were special trains put on to bring these pilgrims into Drumshambo. And the older people will tell you all about that. And I remember I'd be serving mass up there in the 40s, and the place was thronged. You know, you got your Port Yonkin indulgence there, and there was masses, and oh my God, we used to serve mass in the convent and afterwards in the parish church. So times have really changed, Mike, you know.
And then for, we'll say, heating the house, there'd be sticks and maybe turf cut with the slan.
Well, that, yeah, that was all.
Slan and a man or a barra catching the turf and wheeling the note out, you see.
And how many would be involved now on a day like that?
Oh, well, the thing about it is, every man cut his own turf, like a man say, he could spend a week cutting them, that sort of way, and with a helper, wheeling, you see.
And what time of the year would that be done at?
Well, it could be done in April or May.
And we reared the turf and brought them home.
They'd be spread first, and they put on before it. And these things are going to clamps. And from clamps in rake clamps. And my home be horse and cart then. There were no tractors that time. Horse and cart.
And Cullum Balls.
Yeah.
Would you have done the Cullum Balls?
Yeah.
We never did that here in this house.
Yeah.
You take the daub out of the hill and mix it up like cement. And you have to put the column through it and mix it like concrete.
And how much daub would you put into it? There'd be lots of daub around Leitrim.
No, there was. It was great daub for it.
Oh, no. Yeah. True. Too. Yeah.
Was it a certain type of daub?
Oh, it was that blue daub. It was blue. And you have to mix it well.
Yeah, the dust coming off coal and like that, you see. Coal ground up into column, you see, and then dust. And that was... You could buy that by tons, and then you put out so much, and then you go to a job in the field and get so much of that for sticking. The you mix it up with water and all the corn, water, and a bit of job, and that will leave a sticky plaster, and you make that into balls, and you put it in with your hands, and put that on the fire, make a great fire.
And would the daub burn?
Yeah, all burn.
So how many shovelfuls, we'll say, of daub?
No, I don't know how much was. I can't remember that. There wasn't much measure it was.
Yeah. And then what you'd mix through that then, would that be like slack?
Slack, yeah.
That'd be what it was.
No, that's what people used to go up to it for the slack, just the column.
Would you have gone fishing at all when you were growing up?
No, I never went fishing. A lot of people fished around here, but I never fished. I don't know why, but well, on a weekend, or a Saturday, or especially on a Sunday, I was in the pipe band, and the band was nearly away every Sunday, so that's where I used to spend a lot of my Sundays.
I heard that some people, when they would have gone fishing, they would have used just maybe a bit of a bamboo stick and a bit of line and a hook on it. And
They wouldn't buy a new fishing rod, they'd make their own rod and put the hooks in, put the grubs on the hooks and caught the fish that way.
What kind of fish would they catch with that?
They'd be trout mostly. There wouldn't be that much salmon though, they'd be mostly...
And they'd be kept and part of the dinner table?
They'd eat the fish at home, and then if they'd over and above, then they'd probably sell them to their neighbours or whatever.
Oh, I've seen hard Danes. I was over in the hard Danes, that far back, as far as that goes. Yeah. I was over in the hard Danes, yeah, when the ration was on. Yeah. And no lamp oil. Candles. Yeah. Ration, you got a certain amount of ration of oil, but it didn't do. But you had to do it. Yeah. And food, you can see. Ration of food, you see, yeah. I seen all that in my day.
And can you remember down through the years then, Pat, about the weather and, you know, the way it's gone now, there's a lot of storms and they're doing these storms A, B, C, D. And
you wouldn't have that amount of storm in my team. Wouldn't have that amount of storms. No way.
And what about rain? Was Ireland always wet?
Oh, it was. No mistake. Oh, aye.
Did your brother have the cure of warts?
Oh, that's right. Just my mother had it, I think she gave it to him.
Yeah. And how was that done then?
With rushes. The rushes and prayers. I don't know what the prayers was. But they had to have great belief in it.
Yeah.
I don't know. There was a great lot about cure. But I don't know what now cure. Our children don't have to think of. If she had that going on.
Yeah.
There'd be two married with one name. And you go to them. I mean, if there was two go-queens.
Yeah.
The girl was go-queen and the bride and the groom was go-queen. You know
yeah.
that? And whatever they tell you to eat. This was a cure for children who they should think of when they bango. The people believed in that.
Yeah.
I don't think they would know.
Elizabeth Moffatt now talks about another Irish tradition which involved the picking and shaking of mayflowers for the 1st of May.
When they're shutting right to them into the house. And they were lovely. There was a lovely yellow cup on it. The mayflower. It used to go on the meadow somewhere. They wouldn't go on everyone's land. Mm. They were nice. I remember them well.
And was, when they shake them, was it at the corners of the house that they put them? I think they still do it
at the front door. It was the front door and on the windowsill.
Yeah.
Around the house.
That's where we leave our look back at Christmas past. My thanks to John Joe Farrell, to Pat Flynn, to Elizabeth Moffatt, also known as Babby Costello, Jackie Lee and John Joe McGirl for sharing their memories with me. We'll leave you now with Mary Whiting and the Mellow Men and the Mistletoe Kiss Polka. Until next time, from myself, Mike Mulvihill, Happy Christmas. Goodbye.
When the party starts and the night is young, go and find where the mistletoe's hung. And if standing there is a pretty miss, get yourself a mistletoe kiss. If she looks at you with her wondering eyes, just pretend it's a big surprise. You can find romance and a lot of bliss through a simple mistletoe kiss.
While your arms are round her, your heart says you found her, and you won't astound her with your I love you.
When the party's over and there you are, what do you say to her ma and pa? They will understand when you tell them this. Blame it on the mistletoe kiss.
Thank you.
starts and the night is young. Go and find where the mistletoe's hung, and if standing there is a pretty miss, get yourself a mistletoe kiss. If she looks at you with her wondering eyes, just pretend it's a big surprise. You can find romance and a lot of bliss through a simple mistletoe kiss. While your arm's around her, your heart says you've found her, and you won't astound her with your I love you. When the party's over and there you are, what do you say to her ma and pa? They will understand when you tell them this. Blame it on the mistletoe kiss. Lots of fun you're sure to